Every 8th of July, the county down village of Saintfield is awash with colour as it celebrates its identity as one of the hubs of Orangism today. At the centre of an area of centuries-old Scottish settlement, in the 18th century it boasted one of Ireland's largest and most forward-looking Presbyterian congregations, zealous for constitutional reforms that would give both nonconformists and Roman Catholics equal rights with Ireland's Anglican ruling class, and offer the island a system of government inclusive of all its inhabitants. Today, a sea of banners celebrate key moments like the Siege of Derry, in which 10,000 defenders died, the martyrdom of early church reformers, King William, who delivered Ireland's Protestants from the threat of ethnic cleansing in 1690, and more recent events like the Battle of the Somme, in which thousands of Ulster and Irish lives were sacrificed. The Orange celebrations mix religious and family values in a celebratory day out, which is an important affirmation of cultural identity. In a Protestant community where dissent is the essence of freedom and dozens of Protestant sects compete with each other, Orange festivities provide a vehicle for expressing a shared British identity. It's a carnival day in which young and old can be together, remember lost friends, enjoy the colourful pageantry, the music, and a familiar sense of belonging. But it's also an exorcism of a deeply rooted fear of extirpation. Today, Anglicans and dissenters walk side by side, yet in the 1798 rising, Saintfield's Presbyterians ranged themselves against the King's men of the York Fencible Regiment, which numbered many English Orangemen from a lodge founded by the son of King George III. Two weathered tombstones, a tiny plaque in a Saintfield graveyard, and this memorial in Cumber Parish Church are mirror images of that day's tragic sacrifice to conflicting ideals that divided the Protestant community in the 98. The memory of the Yorkshiremen who lost their lives in Ulster soil lives on today in a name and number, that of their lodge, LOL145. As Belfast's silent streets await the big parade, in Clifton Street Hall, one of Ireland's oldest lodges is getting ready to break the tradition and make the 12th of July celebrations a moment of historical pageantry, going to the field in the costumes of the 98 in a horse-drawn break. Hard hats and sashes are hung up in favour of a tricorn and a red coat. It was an opportunity to inform and stimulate the public, to meet American friends on equal terms, and chase up historical and genealogical connections. Many American revolutionaries were Scots-Irish Presbyterians. The success of the new American Republic led some of their kindred in Ulster to dream of forging in Ireland a new state that would be ecumenical, inclusive, and internationalist. Others remained loyal to their British identity and the ideal of constitutional monarchy. Beyond the euphoria of one of the biggest parades on earth, this year's journey to the field ultimately led to a journey back in time, as York Lodge began to explore the reasons that lay behind the inception and growth of Orangism itself, and the parallel rise in Ulster of the mainly Presbyterian United Irishmen. An extraordinary coalition between York Island Arts and Heritage Association, local lodges, two cross-community living history groups, and a dedicated team of actors led to a first public re-evocation of the 98 Rebellion and the Battle of Saintfield. Liberty or death, the cry of Ulster's idealistic rebels, was culled from the French revolutionaries' Marseillaise.
Death to the French! Death to the French!
From the idea of re-evocation came the idea of dramatization. And so, for 10 days in August, our cast walked out of their everyday lives and onto the film set to make the telling of this important chapter of our history possible. The Ireland of the late 18th century was like a rumbling volcano. For a century, peace had reigned, and the Ulster linen industry prospered, despite trade restrictions imposed by London. But neither Roman Catholics nor nonconformists had any voice in government, and power was firmly in the hands of a narrow Anglican, Anglo-Irish oligarchy. Born at Mountstewart in County Down, Robert Stewart, later Lord Castlereagh, was the first leader of Scots Presbyterian stock to break that monopoly. The son of Lord Londonderry, he was a man of progressive principles and was elected to Parliament for his home county at the age of only 21 in a fiercely contested election against Lord Moira, who represented the old aristocracy. His pledge to reform won strong support from prominent Presbyterians like Dr. George Birch and his brother, the Reverend Thomas Ledley Birch. The future Lord Castlereagh proudly declared upon election, "I love the cause of the people," a cause that he pledged himself to maintain. Like future revolutionaries Theobald Wolfe Tone and Archibald Hamilton Rowan, Robert Stewart was a member of the reforming Northern Whig Club. So radical was the climate in Presbyterian Eastern Ulster in 1791 that Tom Paine's The Rights of Man sold like hotcakes, and Belfast's rising merchant class joyously celebrated the progress of the French Revolution and vociferously championed votes for Roman Catholics in the press. None more so than the Reverend Thomas Ledley Birch of Saintfield. He was married to his cousin, Isabella Ledley, whose surname he assumed. Ministering to one of Ireland's largest Presbyterian flocks, Birch was a Freemason and outspoken contributor to the radical Northern Star newspaper. He founded the First Society of United Irishmen in County Down and became increasingly critical of kingship. His brother, George Birch, J.P., remained close to Castlereagh, whose reforming ardour was soon cooled by the responsibilities of power.
I say, Tom, I know you're hot on this reform thing, but really, don't you think you're going a bit too far? I mean, saying you'd rather go to Botany Bay than see the Catholics deprived of their emancipation.
But we got young Castlereagh elected, but there's no sign of the progress he promised
with
us all.
With the risk of rebellion and a French invasion in everyone's mind, look, it's hardly the time. Come along, boys. Say goodbye to your aunt and uncle.
Goodbye, boys.
George must have been concerned by the radical company his brother kept and the extreme nature of his opinions. His Botany Bay declaration reviled emancipationist Henry Joy's proposal for gradual Catholic emancipation as tantamount to leaving men in the most abject slavery.
United for our country.
Come in.
Good evening, gentlemen. Welcome to Liberty Hall.
Good evening, sir.
Colonel Fraser.
Good evening, sir.
Mr. Nicholas McGain. These gentlemen are parishioners of mine. Please, gentlemen, be seated. We are here today to form ourselves into a society of united Irishmen for the furtherance of a radical change in the constitution of this land.
Hear, hear.
And now, gentlemen, the oath. I, Thomas Ledley Birch, in the presence of God,
do solemnly promise that through divine assistance I shall endeavour to cultivate friendship with and between persons of every religious profession, and I shall be aiding and assisting by every lawful means in promoting the religious and civil liberties of the people of Ireland. The United Irish Oath pledged constitutional reform, but old tunes were soon used to sing new songs, exhilarating French hymns to liberty, equality, and fraternity. Meanwhile, in the linen triangle of Armagh, Monaghan and Tyrone, the high-flown rhetoric of revolution fell on deaf ears. Land hunger fostered sectarian strife. Roman Catholic defender associations threateningly pledged themselves to quell the nation of heresy. Their violent attacks and mutilation of livestock excited the reprisals and house burnings of the Protestant Peeper Day boys. The country's main source of wealth became a bone of contention, as Catholic weavers, newcomers to the industry, undercut their Protestant rivals. No one's hearth was safe, as the horrific torture and murder of a Forkhill schoolmaster and his wife proved the predominantly Anglican Protestants of County Armagh. Matters came to a head in 1795 at the Diamond near Loch Gall, where Dan Winter's Vintners, a Peeper Day's meeting place, was attacked by a 300-strong Catholic mob. Many Protestants had got wind of the danger, and as Dan's house burned, they ranged themselves out of sight along the ridge above the Diamond. As the mob triumphantly pursued Dan and his sons up the hill, they were met by a concerted volley, not only from Peeper Day boys, but also from reputable Protestant farmers, fearful for their community. At the end of the Battle of the Diamond, 48 defenders lay dead. In the green fields of Armagh, Protestant farmers, many of them Freemasons, vowed to mutually defend their homesteads and the liberties of the Williamite Constitution. Thus the Orange Brotherhood was founded, and derived many of its symbols and ceremonies from Masonic rite.
Well, Winters, since the incident last year to which you fell a victim, thousands have flocked to join the lodges, and His Majesty is very enthusiastic. His sons have been issuing warrants to the English and Scottish regiments here, but we need a degree system. And Mr. Templeton, you have been our inspiration and guide. What would you suggest, sir?
I am just a country Freemason, but I would suggest we take our inspiration from the children of Israel as they crossed the Red Sea. They had their markers that signposted the way. Should we not have our markers and make them purple like the curtains of the Ark of the Covenant?
An excellent suggestion. To the purple, then.
A central organisation and formal degree structures were rapidly adopted. Respect all men and love the Brotherhood would be the Orange motto. As terror reigned in France and invasion fleets massed along the French and Dutch coasts, the government encouraged the new Brotherhood. Orangism spread like wildfire, even as the United Irishmen secretly sought French intervention. Over 700 lodges sprang up, and their rites were popular with the English and Scottish regiments stationed in Ireland. Amongst the first to seek a lodge warrant were the York Fencibles, raised by Anglo-Irishmen Colonel Granville, Anson, Chetwynd, Stapleton.
It is the Ark of God. Why do you make purple your colour? Because the ornaments on the curtains on the Ark of God were purple, blue and red. I chose purple for mine. Welcome. Thank you.
A century after the Boyne, King William was back in the saddle, symbolic icon of the constitution he had created.
Memory of His Majesty King William and the Constitution.
To the immortal memory!
Meanwhile, with the seizure of documents in Alexander's Tavern in Belfast in 1797, the government became painfully aware that the United Irishmen had abandoned their constitutional methods for a military conspiracy to topple the government.
All small fry. The general tenor is clear enough. Assassination committees, a network of command, and links with both the French and the defenders. We need the unsuspectables. See if you can infiltrate.
Of course, sir.
There's a defender fellow, McKeown. Word has it he's one of the ringleaders. See if our young lady friend can get any joy out of it.
Yes, sir.
The military picked up radicals and consigned them to a prison tender in Belfast Loch. The government also worked through spies, like the prostitute Belle Martin, and informers like Nicholas McKeown, to identify and arrest suspects.
Tell your mentor in the castle that I'm now in a position to give him some of those names he needs. There are certain Presbyterian clergy, and some professional gentlemen, that are up to their necks in it.
You don't give a damn about King George the government. Why are you selling your friends out like this?
Your young friend Castlereagh would see me swing if I didn't collaborate. Anyway, following French fashions does nothing for Catholicism. They burn our convents. They guillotine our clergy. And besides, you should know better than anyone. We all have our price.
McGeown went unsuspected and passed much inside information about the down United Irishman to the government. Nevertheless, violent arms thefts grew rife, and General Lake imposed draconian disarmament measures throughout Ulster, leaving Parliament to debate on how to deal with the imminent invasion threat. In this climate of repression, 11 of the Reverend Ledley Birch's flock were brought before the Downpatrick Assizes, accused of attacking the home of Loyalist Hugh McKee and assaulting local yeoman Richard Harper. Birch probably penned the attack on Saintfield magistrate Nicholas Price, which appeared in the Northern Star. He attended the assizes and was seen to laugh at the prosecution's implausible evidence.
Mr. Ledley Birch.
Mr. Sheriff.
Mr. Birch, I'm afraid there have been various accusations made against you. Mr. Joseph Harper has it that you were present at the assault of his son Richard, and that you tried to bribe him £50 to drop the charges against your congregation.
Oh, nonsense, sir. There is not one shred of evidence against them, or me.
He is willing to testify, sir. Besides, there have been other allegations. It has been stated that you would welcome a French invasion, and that you would be willing to lead men in rebellion yourself.
Mr. Sheriff, I am a man of the cloth.
And nevertheless, it is my regrettable duty to detain you here on the charge of treasonable practices. Take him away!
Ledley Birch and the members of his flock were released on bail, and since talk was rife of a United Irish Assassination Committee in Saintfield, both Joseph Harper and fellow local loyalist Hugh McKee feared for their lives. By the time Ledley Birch's case came to court, Joseph Harper, the chief witness against him, was indeed in no position to testify. Another murder in Ards led George Birch, J.P., and his fellow yeomanry officers to raise a reward to bring United Irish arms thieves to justice. Meanwhile, the Northern Star attacked the Insurrection Act in its editorials and through poems like Parting Ode to Trial by Jury, and the provocative poem Up. In response, the mainly Roman Catholic Monaghan militia broke its presses. It ceased to publish, but French songs of revolution continued to call the people to arms, and everywhere men cropped their hair as a sign of radical affiliation. A campaign of intimidation shook the nerves of those loyal to the government, as renegade croppies planted liberty trees, symbols of the French Revolution, on their land. Since the radicals loudly enunciated a political creed of equality which denounced all inherited office and wrote kings off as hereditary usurpers of powers, the United Irish Oath became treason. William Orr was hanged in Carrickfergus by a drunken jury for having administered it. The Belfast newsletter carries his condemnation and the news that a massive Dutch invasion fleet had been defeated. Despite a lack of foreign aid, in late May of 1798, the rising began in the south. But before the north could mobilise, the work of informers like Nicholas McGeown led to the arrests of the High Command in Antrim and Down.
My own constituency, the Reverend Steele Dixon, half the younger Presbyterian ministers, and even professional men of good standing. Take up all you can. With any luck, there will be no rising.
But in a state of great confusion, the rising did take place, as Dr. George Birch, J.P., rode with the Loyalist Newton Yeoman Cavalry, his teenage sons took a very different course.
Where are you off to, George?
Just doing a bit of riding.
Yes, well, take care. Where's your younger brother?
He's already gone to the stables, sir.
Keep an eye to him. He's far too much of a daredevil. Stay on the estate. The whole country's up in rebellion.
Of course, sir.
All over Antrim and Down, men were gathering, dressed in their Sunday best, all wearing something green. Ledley Birch must have been informed that the United Men were in disarray, but he was, nevertheless, sucked into the vortex of rebellion.
Uncle Tom, we've come to join you!
Join me? In what?
The whole country's up, sir. John's out there, too. We're all waiting for you!
Come!
Godspeed our just cause!
A fine drop of wine from Mr. Place's cellar.
We make our base in Mr. Price's estate.
What troops are in the area?
None. The army is so thin on the ground, the Yorkshire fencer bulls have been recalled to defend Belfast.
Of course, the McKees will inform on us.
The McKees? The McKees are dead. Burned alive in their own house. As ye sow, sir, so shall ye reap.
I pray we will not reap the whirlwind.
As hundreds flocked to Saintfield expecting a general revolt, in Cumber, 16-year-old Ensign James Sparks and his fellow Yorkshiremen awaited orders. Here, Colonel Chetwynd Stapleton made the fatal decision to halt his march to Belfast and turn back with some Cumber yeomanry and volunteers to restore order in Saintfield.
Just assemble. Gather round, gentlemen. The gentlemen of the Cumber Yeoman Cavalry will lead the party, along with the Reverend and the local volunteers. Sir? Ensign Sparks, sir. You will lead our column with Drummer Wortley. The artillery will march at the centre. That is all.
The rebels, under brave but inexperienced commanders like Richard Fraser, occupied the Price Estate and the area along the main Cumber Road.
Gentlemen, absolute silence until the column is entirely within our power. Then, on my signal, fire at point-blank range. Is that understood?
Yes.
Yes.
Hidden behind high hedges, the rebels waited until the York fencibles and militia were deep into the territory they now controlled.
Can we halt, sir?
Yeah, very well, but send a patrol forward. Look for rebels on the road.
These rebels, sir, God shall make them a stubble to our swords.
Quite so, Reverend, quite so.
Are you all right, Mr. Spark, sir?
No, not really, Sergeant. The McKee house and those charred bodies and...
Oh, don't worry. They'll run like rabbits when they see us.
It was a bright, hot summer afternoon as less than 500 government troops walked into a massive ambush. Thanks to the dense vegetation, military scouts failed to detect the vast build-up of rebel forces in the area.
Yorkshiremen and Orange brethren. Love the brotherhood and clobber the croppies that would have froggy guillotines in our streets. Down, down, croppies, lie down. We soldiers of Erin, so proud of our name, we'll raise upon rebels and Frenchmen our fame. We'll fight to the last with the honest old cause. We got our religion, our freedom and love. We'll fight for our country, our king and his crown. And make all the traitors and croppies lie down. Down, down, croppies lie down.
First to fall was the Rector of Cumber. Government troops, under fire from an invisible enemy, had difficulty in manoeuvring their artillery in the narrow road.
For God's sake, Griffiths, I'm a soldier!
trying our best. We can't get the gun turned around.
Quickly, stop the pieces.
Heavily outnumbered, Captain William Chetwynd's company was cut off, and he bravely attempted to rally his men on open ground.
Gentlemen, you will be safe now.
Move on!
Get on!
Go!
The race of glory was over for 16-year-old James Sparks, but also for the teenage John Birch. The triumph of the United Irishmen's Arms at Saintfield was to be short-lived. Inexperienced leadership, treachery, and the poor support of the Catholic defenders led to the crushing defeat of Balnahinch. Rapidly, the Presbyterian radical shining ideal of an egalitarian republic that transcended ethnic and religious identity was consumed in the flames of ancient animosities. Over 100 Protestants had already been executed or burned alive by Catholic rebels in Scullabogue. Now, another 100 were gratuitously tortured to death by the mob on Wexford Bridge. The pro-government press's publication of first-hand accounts of such horrors had a profound and lasting effect on the Protestant Irish psyche. A republic dominated by a non-enlightened Roman Catholic peasantry, far from being ecumenical, they feared, could only lead to Protestant annihilation. Balnahinch commander, the Anglican linen merchant Henry Munro, was turned in, tried and died heroically, hanged before his own front door in Lisburn. Many rebels were rounded up and summarily executed. Thomas Ledley Birch was arrested and taken to Hillsborough. His trial immediately followed that of Munro, but by now the government preferred penitence to martyrs.
Birch, I must tell you frankly, I expected sooner or later to try your brother for treason, but not your son.
Sir, I am mortified.
Well, I cannot forget that I owe my election to Parliament in part to you and your family. You've already lost one son. The other boy will get off. But as for your brother, it is a well-known fact that he preached at Creevy Rocks on the eve of the Battle of Ballinahinch. The court-martial will send him to preach in heaven if he does not give an example of contrition.
I am sure that will be possible, sir.
You may go.
George!
I ought to kill you myself. My son is dead. You're still alive. Here, read this tomorrow. It might just save your treacherous hide.
This court, having considered the evidence against you, finds you guilty and sentences you to be...
Richard Fraser pleaded guilty and was condemned to death for his part in the Battle of Saintfield.
Take the prisoner away.
Ledley Birch was not so heroic.
Bring in the net.
He had a wife and family to worry about.
Thomas... Ledley Birch, have you anything to say in your defense?
I feel myself particularly happy in my distressful situation to be judged by gentlemen of your experienced justice, humanity, and honor. I think it a misfortune to be prosecuted by men implicated in similar charges with myself. However, as superior wisdom has deemed it, for the public good, I resign. Gentlemen, I may have done wrong, but it was an error. I love my king and country. Will ever pray for their happiness. I have the most perfect confidence in the justice and humanity of this court, and most cheerfully resign my honour and life to its disposal. Sensible that I cannot any longer be either happy or useful in this country, I shall quit His Majesty's dominions, never to return, without subjecting myself to such punishment as is inflicted on persons returning from transportation without leave, and retire to America or some other country not at war with His Majesty.
This court, having taken into consideration the evidence against the prisoner and his defense, are of the opinion that the evidence is not sufficiently strong to affect the prisoner's life, and therefore acquit him of the crimes laid at his charge. Take the prisoner away.
Fraser, I... May God preserve you.
Thomas Ledley Birch, after a brief spell on the Belfast prison tender, boarded the Harmony for New York, where he wrote and published the first account of the 98 in Ulster, Letter from an Irish Emigrant. Richard Fraser's sentence was commuted to deportation to the salt mines of Cilicia. Many fell from exposure on the extenuating journey into penal slavery. Lord Castlereagh, the Ulster Scotch radical, tempered in the fire of an Ireland in revolutionary and sectarian crisis, pleaded clemency. He also sought a permanent solution to the problems of the country he loved, by an act of union that would grant Catholic emancipation and dissolve the corrupt Ascendancy Parliament in Dublin. It was a golden opportunity to encourage the unity of the British Isles. The King approved the union, but protested that Catholic emancipation was contrary to his coronation oath, and rejected it. This fatal snub to loyalist Roman Catholic opinion prompted the resignation of both Castlereagh and British Prime Minister Pitt. Colonel Granville Anson Chetwynd Stapleton left his cousin William and 54 of his little force buried on Saintfield's York Island. In 1801, he brought his men home to Yorkshire. But the lodge founded within his regiment still lives on. Today, that lodge, once a stronghold of English Anglicanism, includes the broad spectrum of Ulster's dissenters. It's been enriched by its collaboration with actors, living history practitioners, and film crew from a wide variety of backgrounds. Perhaps the dedicated efforts of our cast should offer us the hope that the Battle of Saintfield can be remembered as the story of a remarkable people, who had a remarkable vision of the future of mankind, in the midst of an age of great social and political transformation, which forms an important chapter of our complex history.